And welcome to Cat Goggles. Welcome to Cat Goggles Reviews with me, Pussycat. Meow.
Yeah, you're getting all worried, didn't you? Right, listen, little one. No causing trouble, alright? You heard me. Sorry, you heard me. Right, let's get on with it. You gonna be good? Yeah? Right, go on, you go. Go on. Frusk. Right. Hello and welcome to Beer Goggles Reviews with me, Catman. And we've got kind of one of these lovely oldie style bottles. Not sure about oldie style beer because I tasted mild from way back. This is a mild, by the way. And I tasted mild from way back, and it was not the drink it is today. I think Pretty Things done a copy of a Barclay Perkins one that was the same recipe exactly and everything else. Probably different brewing equipment, so they've had to tweak it in it. Maybe even some different hops that have kind of, and certainly different yeasts. And she's going off already. You being good? Yeah, but yeah, certainly different yeast than that, and that makes a whole lot of difference, but as near as damn it as they could get it, and it was very hoppy beer. It was almost like an American IPA, but quite high ABV, it was hoppy and everything else, so the old style was a lot different than the modern style of mild, and the modern style is you got a weak kind of ABV there, kind of a less attenuated beer in it, so excuse me. So it's going to be a little bit sweeter and a little bit kind of, you know, a little bit lighter and a little bit more easily drink, kind of easy drinking. What are you doing? Where are you? It's worse than having kids again, isn't it? Let's crack this open. I know I've not got the right glass. I've got me some Bernardus glass up there. But get me a little ring, my little tiny bottle open. Look how little that is, look. On there, and over that end, and crack it. There we go. Always have a sniff in the neck because you get told different things in the neck. The beer will talk to you differently, you know, and you can kind of combine that, and when you get it in the glass later, you can combine them thoughts and come up with different ideas. Well, with the chew marks in, there's the Guardian and that. It's Guardian and the keys. Usually ravens and things like that are guardians. And there's keys there. Must be keys to St. Peter's Church and that. I believe they've got their own very ancient Walter buried way down deep. What are you doing? Like an artesian well sort of idea or something like that. But that's that's the kind of guardians there. Not sure if he's still being brewed in at the church. I think it's a farmhouse now. Oh, St. Paul's Hall. There you go. And yeah, it's been around for a long while. A classic example of a beer, but I don't know what, I'm not going to get into it. I'll show you it up close if I can, and let you read it if you want to get into it. There's a lot of interesting stuff on there, which is great. I would like to see more about hops and things like that, and what's this and what's that, but look. At least they've got some stuff that's interesting about the brewery and about the beer and everything else, you know. Which is always makes the drink a bit nicer to drink, you know. A bit more pleasant, more pleasant and pleasurable if you've got a little story behind it. Well, that's what it looks like. It's dark ruby. The head is nice and it's kind of dying down in its own time. So I think the head should die down a little bit. It shouldn't stay there forever. It shouldn't have a half-life and all that. And it's dying down naturally. It's natural head. Yeah, it denotes a lot of things, but, you know, it denotes really how stretchy the big the proteins are, which really denotes how much wheat in the beer. So if you've got no wheat in the beer, the barley molecules, the barley proteins, are not quite as stretchy. That's why you don't get, well, you do. You get barley bread, you get all svelts and God knows what other breads in it. But they're usually bulkier because they're not fluffy and bouncy and stretchy. Imagine a chewing gum, if you will. You know, those rubbery or rubber, you know, it's something like that. You blow a chewing gum, it stretches right out to many times its size in it before it goes pop and lets go. And the same as a rubber balloon and things like that, you know. And the same with these. You're blowing little balloons up. Loads of them. And they all pop in before they've got very big and they're not staying around long. And whereas wheat ones, just blow up and hold on. And they hang there, you know. But anyway, that's all the silly science out of the way. Let's have a sniff. Very nice. Very pleasant. But actually, really pleasant. Really nice. Nice little nutty notes. Nice little toffee notes. And then you've got something like blackberries and blackcurrants. Those sort of dark fruits. A little bit of plum. Almost an unripe plum. A slightly sharper plum. It's not sharp, but it's kind of that kind of greener, not green, but, you know, that less dark plum. And that less, like, I think sometimes if you get an overripe plum, it's, you know, it's nice to have a little bit of edge to it. And I think sometimes drinks are the same. I mean, even with big Trappist, even triples and things like that, it's nice to have a slight little diggy little edge in there somewhere. You know, even if it's a burnt orange or something like that, it's nice to have a slight zesty edge of some sort. And this has got something that's not burnt, but it's kind of almost a caramelised off orange, if that's such a thing. Pardon me. Oh look, there's a dog on the top. I love that. It's now turned into a parrot. I can't tip it up and show you, but the thingy on the top, the little clouds in the froth. Right, it's one more sniff. Nice biscuity notes, nice kind of those little toffee biscuits and things like that, lovely stuff. There's a Christmas biscuit that they do, I can't remember the name of it, that they do in Belgium, I believe. It smells like that, little Christmassy biscuit. I don't know if they're windmills or crosses or something like that, but little Christmassy biscuits. Sometimes they're quite often at Christmas, they're in the shape of a little Santa Claus thing. Like, well, not what they see as Santa Claus, slightly different to our one. Our one's a big tubby fella and that, you know. Anyway, cheers everyone. That's what a good mild should be. That's really nice. It's got nutty notes in there. Nice little nutty notes. Nice little kind of little peanut brittle edges. Little the skins off of peanuts as a bitterness. Little bitter edge. There's tea, kind of something like a Assam tea on the finish. That bitter Assam tea finish. That's nice, really nice as a finish to it, because it dries up the big lush notes in it. Because there's lovely little sweetness. It's not overdone sweetness. Really nice sweetness going on there. Little kind of muscovado sugar, little just gently sprinkled around it. Ooh. Yeah, I could sit and session that there for a long while, you know. I could session a few of them. Was it 3.7, 3.8? Just a minute. So it's well within session, well within session region. And also, I don't know if you know this, but with beers being of session thing and everything else, if you've got a very, very hoppy beer, it will get you drunk with the same ABV. Say that they're 4.8 or something like that. Pardon me. Gassy. Pardon me. If they're at 4.8 and you've got a really hoppy beer, that will get you drunk quicker than a much less hoppy beer of 4.8 as well. And now you think, well, they're both the same alcohol, but they're having different effects on the body because the kind of the resistance to alcohol is lowered because there's a sedative effect in the hops. That's why they have like hop pillars to help you relax. Off you go. And hop oils to, you know, for babies and whatever. You put them near there and off they go. And all sorts of other things. Hops have got a sedative effect and they relax and everything. Yeah, I think you can get hops in teas as well. And they have the same sort of thing for helping people sleep. Excuse me, sniffing like a bit of a cold. So a hoppy beer will get you more drunk than a less hoppy one. That said, this has got its hops in there because you can taste them biting, but they're earthy sods there. Very pleasant. Very, very pleasant. It's one of those that it's kind of good old English brewing. It's not going to win massive awards. I don't think, you know, it's not going to win, like, you know, it's not going to make people go, wow, woo. But it's a lovely, lovely, lovely beer. It's kind of that thing where, what do you want? You know, do you want to go out and have some sort of Gordon Ramsay 5-star thing with elaborate this and that, and oh wow, and look at the way they've done this, and foie gras, and you know, that sort of stuff, foie gras, and this has got you know, truffles, truffle oil, foie gras, and caviar all mixed in, and you go, what? Yeah, it probably is really lovely, but get good, proper, old, you know, two fat ladies, big fat stew, ooh, you know, that sort of thing, or you know, something really hearty and meaty, a big shepherd's pie or something beautifully done. When it's done really well, it's a simple recipe, you know, lamb, bit of rosemary, bit of this, that and the other, you know, salts and peppers and things, mash on the top. Done well, it's just gorgeous, absolutely glorious. And this is what that is. It's good home cooking, really done well. Good English, honest cooking, you know, that sort of thing. And that's what this is. It's good British or even English, kind of honest, lovely, beautiful brewing. And that, done it its best, you know. And that is really lovely. So, rambling on. Dun 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 dun. Try it, buy it, and love it. Yeah, that is lovely. Really nice. Give it a go. I'll see you in the next one. Don't be late. Cheers. I like it. That means next. Bye.